Yep. So we are here for day three of a workshop on examination reforms. And the agenda for this session is going to be, as it has been announced in last 2 days by all the speakers, Dr. Archana Mantri, Honorable Vice Chancellor of Chittagong University, then Professor Vijay. Then I had also taken one session on how to prepare the question paper for pertaining to different levels of Bloom's taxonomy, and then another session by Professor Shivani Malhotra. And then you were given a task, all of the participants were given a task that you were supposed to prepare some question papers of whatsoever subject, whatsoever course you have been teaching in your respective institutes, and then align those question papers with whatsoever have been you are learning from this workshop, right? And we seek volunteers here. Large number of submissions have been made. We seek volunteers there. Somebody should raise hand that whosoever is ready at this point of time, and then that person will be made the co-host for this session, and he will be asked, he or she will be asked to present that paper here, and then to the best of our ability, we'll be giving our suggestions that how this question paper can be further improved. Or what could have been done to further raise the level of questions, etc. So this is what the agenda of the meeting is. Simultaneously, another thing what we'd like to do is Dr. Archana would be showing some of the question papers which you can treat like not exactly model question papers, but sample question papers which we feel to the best of our ability that those are some good question papers. Those are question papers which are actually in line with the expected examination reforms. So this is how we'll be having next 1.5 to 2 hours of meeting with this particular agenda. So who would go first? Could anybody please raise hand? We do have 550 plus participants in the meeting as of now. So who would go first, please? Whosoever would raise hand first will be given the rights to share the screen and simultaneously make a presentation also. Please raise hand. I'm sure you would be able to see a tab on your respective screens to raise hand. Please raise hand. And yes. Okay. We do have Surinder Umananda KV. He is ready. Please make him co-host and he will be presenting the paper. Umananda KV. Surinder, please acknowledge and then make Umananda KV co-host and simultaneously with rights to share his screen also. Yes, Surinder, Umananda KV has raised his hand. And please make him the co-host. So Dr. Archana, I have just introduced the, told them about the agenda of the this session. And then I had requested them to raise the hand. And one participant, Umananda KV, has shown the interest that he is ready with sharing his paper. And I just requested our IT team to make him the panelist.
Sure. Good morning. There had been, I had posted some important instructions in the chat box. I request all the participants to go through them. And meanwhile, we would be eager to look at the paper which the selected participant is going to share and discuss. Yeah.
Dr. Archana, Umananda has been made panelist. Umananda, please go ahead. Please, you are free to share your screen. Show us your question paper and then explain whatsoever you want to say about those questions in your paper. Are you able to listen? Please acknowledge. Are you able to listen? You have been unmuted. We are able to see. You can switch on your video also so that we are able to further better interact with you. I would request simultaneously our IT team to enable the chat also, because some of the participants have written that chat is disabled. So please.
No, actually, I had chat is disabled for the attendees.
Okay,
I had
fine.
Written something earlier, but I'll retype it again. Don't type anything in the question and answer window also unless you are prompted to. I'll write the instructions once again in the chat window. Umananda, can you please share your screen and start? Are you able to hear us? If yes, please acknowledge on your mic by speaking. Otherwise, other participants can raise hands and we can make them the panelist. Somebody else who wants to share the paper? Yes, Umananda has started.
And maybe, Dr. Rachna, what we can do is we can prompt few of them, ourselves also, if they don't raise the hand themselves.
Sure. Yeah. So, Rajneesh sir, I want you to take on this while I'm typing the instruction. Umananda, sure. Please introduce yourself first, which college, which institute you are from, and then go on to discuss what you have prepared.
Mananda, you need to unmute yourself perhaps so that everybody is able to listen to you. We are able to see your screen so that I acknowledge. You need to scroll down and start presenting it.
No, I think he's not able to, Umananda is not able to speak, or I think there is some problem. Meanwhile, somebody else can raise the hand and share the screen. We will make you co-panelist. Any other participant would like to share what they have prepared?
A lot of people have raised it.
Rajneesh sir, we can also select the participants from the attendees.
Yeah, that's it.
That can also be done. Can you please select somebody?
Yeah. I'm looking at the list of the participants. Ayan Mukherjee is the last name. With the name of participants starting from A, Ayan Mukherjee. Ayan Mukherjee? We'll make you panelist and please share the paper which you have prepared. Another participant after that, Ritesh Bhatt has written in Q&A window. Ritesh Bhatt is ready with his question paper. So I would request Surendra to make Ritesh Bhatt also a panelist, and then Ayan Mukherjee, and then Ritesh Bhatt. Umananda, we were not able to hear anything from your side. Perhaps you need to stop sharing your screen, and so that the next participant can be given the opportunity.
Good morning, everyone. Am I audible?
Yeah, you are audible. Who is this?
This is Ritesh here.
Yeah, Ritesh. Yeah, please introduce yourself and then share your screen, please.
Yeah, this is Ritesh Bhatt, Senior Assistant Professor from Manipal Institute of Technology, Department of Mechanical and Manufacturing Engineering. So I have a paper which has prepared. So with all your permission, I can share it now.
Yeah. Simultaneously, as per custom, as it has been done in earlier workshops as well, simultaneously, you may say something about that. What was, how was your experience of attending this workshop as well on examination reforms?
Yes, it was a pretty good experience for me. Like apart from what you say, these things, I have been also involved as the NBA coordinator for the IP program here. So right. Outcome-based education is something like which I am very much attached to. Right. In due course of time, I have this experience of working for OB in the Malaysian branch of MAHE.
Very
so cool. I have been involved with this from past like nearly 4 years nearly.
Very good.
So yes, this was an add-on to me, coming up with the performance indicators and all for the program outcome. So we are also moving ahead just like any other signatory bodies of the Washington Accord.
Very good.
So great experience. I'm sure that most of them would have benefited with this program. And it will surely help them in the upcoming accreditation process, whether it is NAC or NBA or even IIT.
Excellent. Yeah, Ritesh, please share your screen and share your question.
Yeah, I'll do that.
Thanks a lot for the feedback.
Is the screen visible?
Not
just a moment, I'm doing that.
Next in line would be Dr. Shankar Murthy AG, who is also ready with the, presumably ready with this question paper. Dr. Shankar Murthy AG. I would type his name in the chat window also.
Just confirming whether the screen is visible to all.
Yeah, screen is visible. Yeah, please go ahead.
So this is the course which I'm dealing for all the branches. Like it's an open elective. That I'm dealing. So what you can see over here is like, as it was told earlier also, just a moment, I'm not able to scroll the window after sharing. Yeah. So as it was said earlier also that a question paper should have all the things, all the instructions which are necessary. So the, you know, like semester for which it has been conducted and the program, the credit system and the timing, and then yes, some instructions, and there was no much thing to be told over here, and all the questions are mandatory here. We are not giving any kind of choices here. So before I discuss this question paper, since I have written here CO1, L2, 1.41 and all those things, so I would first go to the last page of this, wherein I have mentioned the CO for all the people to know. So I have these COs with me, wherein it is like describing the fundamental concept of industrial safety engineering applied by a safety engineer to prevent the occurrence of industrial accident. So I have already mapped there. It is for the knowledge purpose PO1. In that, the competency of 1.4. The performance index is 1.4.1. And the Bloom's level that I'll be covering for the questions mapped to this CO will be level 1 and level 2. Similarly, I go to the next CO. It is the apply the mathematical computation to solve the complex engineering problems concerned to industrial safety engineering. Now it is mapped to the problem solving PO, PO2, competency level 2.4, performance index 2.4.1, and the level of Bloom's taxonomy that I'll be using here is 3 or 4, that is apply or analyze.
Okay.
Coming to third one, decide the appropriate OSHA standards and regulatory factors to prevent the hazards caused due to ergonomics and exposure to hazardous situation. That is like for safety and regulation, the PO6. Okay, in that again, 6.2 is the competency, 6.2.1 is the performance index, and Bloom's level is 4. Coming to the next one again, it is regarding to the machine guarding, material handling and storage. So again, on a similar basis, it is for the safety of the work, the worker who is working in the industry. So again, it comes as PO6 for me. The last one is lifelong learning, wherein the students are required to bridge the gap. That is to see like, you know, what as a continuing professional, they can come up with the idea. So PO12, again, 12.1 is the competency. PI is 12.1.1 and Bloom's level, it's only for analyzing. So this is the total mark distribution or contact hours. I have the whole course plan, like from which it was calculated. So we have CO1 for 9 hours, CO2 4, CO3-16, CO4-4, CO4-5, sorry, CO5, 3 hours. So totally 36 hours for that semester. And apparently for 100 marks, on a similar percentage, the marks has been distributed. Now, since it is out of 100, only 50% of it has been taken for the external examination. So again, I had seen to it that 50% of 11, or I took it as 12. So 6 marks, 22 marks, 6 marks, 4 marks, and here again, nearly 13 marks. Okay, so I have taken only the 50% of these things for my end semester examination. And according to that, adhering to the college policy, wherein we are also seeing that we are not going to ask a question for more than 5 marks in the end semester. So I have adhered to that also. So now if you see here, 1A, discuss the CSP certification process. So it is only the discuss part, okay, which is based on their understanding. There's nothing to analyze over here. It's based on their understanding. So map to CO1, as I had discussed earlier, L2 is given here, and the performance index has been mapped. Similarly, discuss the reason behind Vishakhapatnam gas leak case and what should have been done to prevent the industrial accident. So again, it is based on their understanding, because this case will be already discussed in the class. So it is nothing that they will be taking something new from here. So what they would have done if they were the safety engineers. So that understanding level has been put up over here. Now coming to 1C, yes, it needs a kind of analysis. I won't be reading the entire problem. It's a problem for rated weight loading, for required weight loading for ergonomics. It's a problem on ergonomics, wherein they have to refer to few tables, which will be supplemented to them during the examination. They'll have to go through it and they will have to analyze the data and then come with the answer over here. So all the kind of assumptions have been given here, but that's not a direct formula that they have to apply. So it's not just apply, it is analyze. Coming to 2A, explain the system theory of accident. So again, with a suitable example. So how much, if I would have asked just to explain the system theory of accident, it would have been a kind of remembering, because they would have just postulated the theory. Yes, but then I am saying them with a suitable example. Actually, I had to add here with a suitable example of your own. I want them to correlate some accidental thing what they would have thought can be a part of the system theory of accident. So that becomes again understanding. Now coming to this 2B, is the incidence of workplace musculoskeletal disorder increasing or decreasing? Justify your answer. So I am asking their justification based on the analysis, whether it is increasing or decreasing and why in the current scenario, in the industrial scenario. So they have to think upon it and they have to write. So it is completely on the analysis basis that I would say. So similar way, if I see the whole question paper, because it's anyways available in the drive, so anyone can have a look. So I won't be taking much of the time here explaining each of them. So each of them, wherever I have put this L4, analyzing thing, you can see there very clearly that either it is a problem or a kind of case or a design research problem kind of thing, wherein you cannot directly apply the formula and do the thing, but you have to think and do the things. Very good. And yes, a small amount of the lower level things have been kept up. Now, since I am covering most of the remembering part of the Bloom's during my internal assessment through MCQs or something. So that is the reason why I have not added the remembering part in the external exam. And even the apply, I'll be using it in the sessionals rather than in the final exam directly. So this is the division for me. Remembering, as I said, it is covered in even my, the plan is for the formative thing wherein the polls will be asked during the class. So remembering is nil in the exam paper in the end semester. Understanding, yes, for 12 marks out of 50. And then applying, nothing, but directly we have analyzing for 38 marks. And this course is meant to be a kind of practicing course, as it is going to be a basic for the safety engineers. And this is the percentage by which I have distributed the COs. So CO1, 24%, CO2, 12%, CO3, 44%, CO4, 12%, CO5, 8%. Coming it totally to the 100%. Yes. So I think that would be a brief thing from my side.
Dr. Archana, you would like to go for this, or should I first say about this wonderfully prepared paper? Dr. Archana? Okay, anyhow, Dr. Archana is on mute mode. You are a doctor, or you are about to be a doctorate?
Still 1.5 years to go.
1.5, so anyhow.
Yeah, but so I have completed my CN, sir.
Yeah, would be Dr. Ritesh Bhatt. This is a wonderfully prepared paper, right? First, that is take it as a compliment.
Thank you.
In fact, personally, I really like this paper a lot. In fact, whatsoever learnings we wanted to impart to our participants in this workshop, everything has been very, very carefully imbibed in this question paper. In fact, I feel if the other participants got an opportunity to have a deeper look at this question paper, or they can, because this is uploaded in the drive, I'm not sure whether they do have the access to the drive or not, but we would definitely like to share with other participants as well, and they can treat it like a kind of more of a model question paper as well, that this is the kind of effort which should be putting in while preparing a good question paper. I wanted to ask you that, did you actually solve this question paper? Because this is what I had insisted on in yesterday's session.
So I have the solution of this.
Did you solve it yourself?
I have the solution scheme with me, and it can be done within the stipulated amount of time. There is no problem.
Oh, you're sure about the same?
Yes.
Because one thing which slightly off the track, which I could found, that you have told them to assume a lot of things, even in the questions related to analyzing as well. And then the question paper at the top starts with an instruction that assume whatsoever. If we could go to the first page of the question paper, please.
Yeah. Missing data can be suitably assumed.
Missing data may be suitably assumed. So that is a good thing, because it is expected that students should be knowing that what are the right kind of values which are required to be assumed. So they can't, because if they are supposed, if the value of gravity has not been assumed, has not been provided, so they are supposed to assume the value of gravity in the reasonable limit only, right? That to the close to the standard only. So they can't assume a completely unorthodox value of gravity. So same way, if likewise, if Planck's constant value has not been given, so then it means the examiner expects them to remember the value of Planck's constant or any other thing. So that way, having this statement is absolutely.
Sir, actually, can I answer?
Let me complete.
Yeah.
So having this kind of statement is absolutely okay. That's what my personal feeling is. But simultaneously, although we always insist upon this thing that we should have these kind of problems where we should not expect a unique solution to those problems also, right? And so that way you are giving them an option to choose their own value of whatsoever parameters are defined missing in the question paper. So you can have multiple solutions as well. So as a examiner, as a evaluator later, perhaps you will need to have a close look at all the solutions provided by large number of students, whosoever would be attending your course. That is one thing. Otherwise, I think this question paper, as far as aligning each and every single question paper with right CO, with right Bloom's taxonomy level, and indicating the performance, having the performance indicator over there, that is absolutely awesome. That is absolutely fine. Right. I would request if Dr. Archana is available to give comments on
this. I would request I think there is some noise coming in from somewhere, one of the panelists. I would request all the other panelists to mute their mics.
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you. Ritesh. Ritesh, I this question paper can be treated as a model question paper. Apart from other comments, which I'm not going to repeat, the only thing that I want to comment here is that usually the rubric, meaning the distribution of marks in any question which is more than 3 marks, should be inbuilt in the question itself. For example, I will take the question number 4A, which is of 5 marks. Am I right? I think column 3, CO.
Yeah, it is 5 marks.
Right? Yeah. And then 5 marks you have given that rest of the things, rest of the statements are the explanation of the real life situation. And then only last is the question, is the actually the cue where the student has to respond, which is in two portions, which is, do you support the proposed process change? This is the first cue that the student has to answer, and then explain your position. And this whole thing is of 5 marks, right? Now, whenever there is a any question which is of more than 3 marks, you must provide cues as to what cue has how many mark distribution. That should be inbuilt and could be inbuilt. I will not say should be, but could be inbuilt into the question itself. So explain your position based on, you can make certain parameters written there. So explain your position based on parameter 1, parameter 2, based on the problem that you are, situation, the context that you are explaining in the problem itself. So that is just one suggestion that you can take up. Usually what happens is that the evaluation rubric is with the evaluator or with the paper setter, but it is never there with the student. So when he or she goes on to explain your position, this is what is written, explain, whenever he is going to explain his position, he or she may write based on hundreds of things that the position can be explained. So I know that there are many things already there in the context, but it will be better if you explain in the question itself the cues, on based on what cues he has to, what parameters he has to explain the position, right? So that is one suggestion. The second is, can you scroll down? Just a moment. Okay, just go down. The other thing that I see here is that a lot of questions are starting with discuss, explain. Although I understand that industrial safety engineering is a theoretical paper and you have beautifully incorporated the real life scenarios and context into it. But what happens is when you are reading a text, whether it is a question paper or an assignment or whatever, even the responses, if everything is so commonplace and repetitive in nature, whether it is question verbs that you are putting in, you can bring in some variety in terms of the choice of the words that you use in the question paper. The third most important thing that I want to say here is that usually when we bring our content to the classroom, when we bring our pedagogy to the classroom, we bring in a lot of variety. We all agree with it, right? Sometimes we will incorporate pictures, sometimes we will incorporate videos, sometimes we will incorporate graphs, sometimes we will incorporate pie charts, bar graphs, distributions, mathematical formulae, and block diagrams, all those stuff are there, right? But when it comes to question paper, we will have only and only text, which is our words. So in an industrial safety engineering scenario also, I would say, so for example, go to a theoretical question, a bigger one, let's go to where you have explained the scenario. Just a moment, hold on. I'm just trying to look at where you can, what question, or maybe you are the best judge. I am not an expert. So my suggestion to all the participants over here is try to bring in more pictures, variety in terms of all those things which I have just now said. And now, for example, I will just show you a sample paper wherein it's from computer science and engineering background. It's a paper on software engineering concepts. And usually the people who are present here from computer science background would agree with me that this is quite a theoretical paper, quite a theoretical subject, which is there in computer science and engineering. But now I will show you how this paper is so interesting to read. And probably, I'm hoping that all of you would agree with me. But thank you, Riteshji, for sharing this beautiful paper with us. I would say it's quite logically made, and it's very good. It's very good. You have incorporated a lot of real life scenarios and higher level of taxonomy. Thank you very much. Thank you.
That way, alignment with all the levels is very beautifully done. That's what I would
say. Yes.
Very, very wonderful comments.
Thank you.
Riteshji, I do have a little bit of problem. I do have very close eye for the wrong spellings. And on your page number 3 of this document, the spellings for weightage were wrong. That just caught my eye.
Sir, to be very frank, I just used the template which was given. I think the template has that.
Then it's our mistake.
Because I have not corrected anything over there. I just entered the numericals over there. So the template that, which was sent, I think.
That's absolutely
right. I think that's a learning for us.
Thank you.
Never we are sharing anything, we should spell check our own thing. Okay. At this moment, I'm going to share my screen and I hope it is visible now. So this is a question paper on software engineering concepts, as I said. And apart from the first few pages, which are the instructions for the paper setter. So if you look at the instructions which we give to our paper setters are also like this. So even the instruction to the paper setters in our circles is a long, I would say detailed instruction. So section A has at least 2 questions should be based on computation derivation. At least 2 questions should be memory based. 2 questions should be picture equation diagram based. Avoid using none of these. These are the instructions for setting the MCQs, which are of 4 marks. I mean, total 4 marks the section A is. And these are the instructions. Similarly for section B and similarly for section C. These are the instructions. Maybe I'll come back to it later. And this is the distribution of marks in the total paper. So the section A has MCQs, and then again section B is MCQs as well as subjective. Section C is MCQs as well as subjective questions, and section D is subjective only. And now if you look at the questions, I will just scroll down first of all with a greater speed, just to look at what is the variety. I said block diagrams, pictures, flow graphs, all of these things are there. So you see here, I'm just scrolling it down. Apart from text, you will see a lot of symbols, flow graphs, block diagrams. So, you know, all these stuff are there. And then there are real life scenarios. So everything that I have told just now to make a question paper full of variety, even for the student to read. Why do we want to make our question paper so boring? Do you do it ever in your class? Do you always carry only the text, the verbal and the written text to your class when you are teaching? No, you bring in a lot of variety. So think of bringing the variety in the question paper also. Now, if you look at the questions in itself, those of them who are not from computer science background also, maybe just look at the structure of the questions which have been set in here. So these are the MCQs. And none of them is as Riteshji was also saying, none of them is a straight question coming out of the books. By the way, it's a good thing to run a plagiarism check on the question paper itself. See, as teachers, we always want our students not to plagiarize when they are writing their responses. So why do we plagiarize when we are setting our question papers? Why do we copy the questions from the textbooks and the internet? Why should we do it? We should never do it. So sometimes in our university, we also run plagiarism check on the question paper itself. So the teachers have to actually think of the design statements of the scenarios of these things, and they have to frame their own questions. I'm sure you are able to look at these questions, and I will go scroll down. See, this one is a MCQ. You will see MCQ of 2 marks, and there is a block diagram here. And then they are asking whether it is a structural model, context model, behavioral model, or interaction model. some fill in the blanks are also there. Even reasoning, the effect and cause kind of questions, or statement and effect kind of questions are also there. So you will see the read at the question number 12, which is again an MCQ, which is fill in the blanks. Now, if you look at question number 13, again, you will see that section B is only 2 marker, right? So if you look at the keywords which are used in the question, setting the question paper, they are also related to, identify, list, what kind of cues are there, because it's only, the response is only marked for 2 marks. While section C is of 4 marks. Now, if you look at even the MCQ, this is of, this one is really worth giving 4 marks. And they are at the higher level autonomy. Then section D is of 8 marks. But here, as I was telling to Ritesh ji also, that somewhere, whenever the question is more than 3 marks or 4 marks, the cues and the rubric should be distributed in the question itself. And this is what you can see over here. See, look at this sentence. As I said, you can specify the parameters on which you want the student to explain any term. So give an assessment of the problems likely to be encountered in this task. Explain how you would go about the reverse engineering of this system in reference to. I could have just ended the statement over here. Just over here. Explain how you would go about the reverse engineering of the system. But then again, the parameters are explained here in reference to estimating project planning resource required. Outline the techniques and tools that you could use and the results that you would expect to produce. So these are all the cues which are inbuilt in a higher marker question. Okay, so with that, I will just stop sharing my screen. And this is all from my side. And we will ask now, Rajneesh sir, who was
we
the next
had
one?
Doctor, we had requested Dr. Shankar Murthy AG. He's already been made panelist. Dr. Shankar Murthy, you may go next. Please share your screen and say about your question paper, what you have prepared.
Meanwhile, we welcome Colonel Venkat from AICT. He has just joined. Welcome, sir.
Good morning, Colonel Venkat.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am. Please continue, ma'am. I've just joined in. Aap log, you are doing wonderful. Just continue, ma'am. I'll be listening, ma'am.
Sure, sir. Sure. Thank you.
And in the meantime, I would choose the next participant because now a lot of participants have raised hands.
So, Dr. Shankara Murthy, kindly explain what you have made.
We would go next by with Shruti Narayanan. So I would request the IT team to make her the panelist. Shruti Narayanan.
Yeah, Dr. Murthy, please go ahead. Unmute yourself and start speaking what you have made. Introduce yourself also and also give little feedback, any criticism that you have for this workshop, we would like to improve upon. I believe he is not able to speak.
Dr. Murthy, you are already unmuted. Please speak out and acknowledge. We are not able to hear anything. Okay, Shruti Narayanan has already been made panelist. Maybe we can request Professor Shruti Narayanan to share her screen and then explain her paper. Dr. Shankara, we'll come back to you. Please resolve your problem of microphone, because we were not able to hear anything here. We are not able to hear anything. Professor Shruti Narayanan, please share your screen. She has been made panelist, but I think either she is not close to her machine or.
Rajneesh sir, agla le lo.
Yes, yes, that's the time. Okay, Dr. Praveen Kumar has raised his hand. Dr. Praveen Kumar, IT team, could we make Dr. Praveen Kumar as the panelist, please?
Yes, this is Dr. Praveen Kumar.
Yeah, you are very clearly audible. Very good, sir. Thank you.
From Rajasthan Technical University, Kota. So, I thank you for selecting me to share my assignment and hear my views. So, may I share the screen, sir?
Yeah, absolutely. Please go ahead with sharing your screen and simultaneously, as Dr. Archana also told, please share your feedback about the workshop as well.
Yes.
Anything you would like us to improve, yes, in the, yes, future workshops, etc.
So I think Professor Rajneesh Sharma ji or other panelists, Professor Vice Chancellor Madam, I think the screen is visible.
Yes, screen is visible, sir.
So first of all, very good workshop, and the pace of the delivery and the quality of the delivery and the explanation was very good. And even it helped me a lot in designing a sample question paper. So I just wish to share that this is a fourth semester civil engineering core paper at our university. So first of all, let me share I had written four COs. I have been using these in my teaching. So it can be seen that the fourth CO, of course, caters to mainly fourth level of Bloom's taxonomy. And while teaching, I give it the first lecture, what are the prerequisites, and I intend to cover up those prerequisites if someone is deficient in that. Then, of course, this last summary table, and I will come to the questions. But this part also had been announced previously in the class, that how much percentage each CO will be given. So as discussed yesterday by the expert, approximately conforming to that, not exactly possible. Professor Rajneesh Sharma perhaps told you that. And L5, L6, I could not make it properly in the end term examination, though in the internal assignments part, I have been giving them questions, assignments on Bloom's taxonomy levels 5, particularly 5. 6 is quite difficult and still not finding perhaps possible in the second year BTech level. Now, I have tried, these questions are on the last year's actual end term question paper, which was given to the students. Some questions are, of course, new. So this is a question, very simple question, but it requires statistical inference. That's why I have put it at Bloom's level 3. And of course, it conforms to CO4. Then this is simply understanding level, because physical properties of aggregates is not only remembrance, but it is for use in concrete. There may be several things, more hardness, but that is not useful. Specific gravity is one, those of you who are from civil engineering background can agree with me that the physical properties which are of utility in the concrete making are to be understood and then to be written here. then maximum height of dropping is again put in the Bloom's taxonomy level 2, because this requires the understanding, proper understanding of the physical principles and what will happen if the height will be more. So this is generally answer is 1.5 meters approximately. Similarly, this I have put in the question number 4 on question level 3. As madam was saying, VC madam was saying that we have tried and we try in our teaching learning process to give a variety of questions. So this is very simple, but this is a particular case study type, a particular city, Jaipur, which is very common to our students. We have students mainly from Rajasthan. So they know what is the climate in Mumbai. So they can correlate and then they need to give the this value. So that's why this has been put in a higher third level, means not second level or first level. This is also requires some understanding, proper understanding. That's why I put in one. So as I was saying that our students, particularly base, we have to move slightly towards the higher levels of learning. So of very few questions from first level and second level also. Now, remembrance level. But of course, these need to be minimized further. This is also, this gives a student to think, ninth number question. So what, say, typical diameters are 25 mm and 50 mm of the needle vibrator. So which diameter is suitable for this? And if more reinforcement is there, smaller diameter need to be used. So this gives this, that's why it is put instead of second to third level. And here also unwanted material, the student has to think which material, that's why this is put in second level, not in first level. This is of course, when a student draws a curve, then it goes to second level, not curve cannot be mugged and so on. This is a very good question, a very fundamental understanding, but application. And I have been using similar question in my teaching since last 3-4 years and found that this becomes a difficult question. That's why has given to fourth level. And if it is, if some student gets through it, it will be good for him. It will be easy for him to apply this knowledge to CO4. Similarly, this is, we teach in the CO2 mineral admixtures, but mineral admixtures, this student has to think and apply the knowledge. That's why it is put in fourth level. So this way I have tried to put about 36% in the fourth level and 26% in the third level. Thank you for giving me the opportunities.
Very good, Dr. Praveen Kumar. Dr. Vijay Jadhan, would you like to give your comments on the contents of this question paper and the way Dr. Praveen Kumar has explained the whole question paper? Dr. Vijay, please.
Thank you, Dr. Rajneesh. I was very impressed, number one, with the framing the CO. Can you show the COs, please? If all others basically can also see the way the COs have been framed, because I personally feel that framing CO is most important task whenever we are trying to implement OBE. And these COs are largely Bloom taxonomy based, not the content based. When I was going through the queries that were raised when I was taking the session, second session, and there were some questions related to the CO, how the COs to be framed, how many number of COs should be there, how to identify what should be the optimum number of COs. So I suppose this is the best example that you, all of you, can go through it and see how the COs should be framed and how the number of COs you can very easily identify. But certainly a few things which may, the other thing which basically should be focused is if some mapping to PO or this attainment of PO is not possible from a complete course structure, then you can add any additional CO which may not be directly linked with the content. So that is what basically is the, I must appreciate the effort of Dr. Praveen to frame the wonderful COs. It's very impressive, basically. Generally, I see whenever I go through the COs, it is generally content-based. Whatever content that is there in the syllabus, on the, that basis we frame CO. So this is very good as far as the CO framing is concerned. So that is very good example, and all participants should go through the CO, and especially those who are from the civil background, they can now correlate the CO of this particular course and to the courses that they teach. So they will very well understand how the CO are to be framed. Second part is about the Bloom taxonomy mapping. So this PI mapping is not there, I suppose, in the question paper, that is performance indicator mapping. Is it there? Oh, that is there.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, that is there, yes, in the last. So suppose that need to be worked upon slightly in better way. If I take example, because if, when I go through, I am not basically from the civil domain, but certainly when you go through the question paper, Bloom's level, you have given Bloom's level to question number 2, 3 and many others at level 2. But in my opinion, they largely related to level 1. But certainly you have your own logic that you have already explained, that they, it is not directly, you can say, taken from the knowledge, remembering knowledge, but they have to understand the basic knowledge and then only they will be answering it. But if I see, you can say, without being expert of the civil engineering, name 3 physical properties of, yes, question number 2 I suppose trying to read. Name 3 physical properties of aggregate for use in concrete. There may be 4, 5, 6 properties and I have to write 3. I don't think that is some understanding is required for that. So it should go to the remembering. So that is what basically, and there are such few more questions which you have mapped with level 2, but they can go to the level 1. Can you scroll up the another thing that is, or let us stay back here at 2. If you see the PI mapping, the PI mapping is 1.2.1. If it is as per AICT, you can say policy document, then 1.2.1 read is apply laws of natural science to an engineering problem. So that is what. So I don't think that basically this particular question is mapping to this PI. So it is not applying apply law of natural science to an engineering problem. This question is not basically taking help of any laws of natural science for any problem. So this mapping, I suppose, is not that accurate. So that need to be worked upon, and that is that you may find in almost many of this mapping of PIs. So you can now scroll up, so that this, that you will be able to map PI properly if we have understood the POs. So whenever we are mapping anything for any question paper, CO mapping, this PI mapping or Bloom taxonomy mapping, you cannot do the things in isolation. You have to collectively understand the things. You have to take the help of PO, basic PO understanding, then only you will be understanding the PI's competencies and PI's. Then the CO is another important thing. If we have framed the COs correctly, then it is very easy to map with PI and PO directly. So another important thing which I see, you scroll up, you come at the end of this. The summary sheet that you have drawn, you have prepared. So this summary is, I consider this summary as very good summary. I am not basically now relating to the questions. As far as the marks distribution is concerned, I generally prefer not to give any rather remembering type question, because again, it has been told number of times in the during the workshop that teaching is a philosophy, and it is on perception. I am saying my own perception on the basis of some logic, which I am already also explaining. Similarly, though I spend hardly 2 minutes for explaining that Bloom taxonomy pyramid, but if you understand the things properly, if we are capable of analyzing a thing, or some question is mapped to the analyzing level, it should not be basically considered to other levels, though you have put the things in correct order. What I basically try to emphasize here, there are two things. One is related to your summary, and another is the general thing, that each question should only consider or map to one Bloom taxonomy level. If you are able to understand, you will be able to understand only if you have remembered something. You can only apply if you understand something. You can analyze if you are able to apply. So if I am basically mapping to level 4, then you need not to map to the level 1. So that is what basically, this is general, not related to your question, because I got the opportunity. So that is why I thought I must share my view on Bloom taxonomy and mapping these things. So as far as this summary is concerned, though it is very, very very, very, you can say, meticulously done, and the distribution is also very good, but still, I suppose the question level to the understanding still can be reduced, and remembering there is no need to have. Just see, as far as my even the lecture was concerned, we should always focus on the complex engineering problem, and we should create the problem or formulate the questions which may lead to solve complex engineering problem. So when we talk about that, the collective remembering and understanding should not go beyond 10 to 15%. That is why what my perception is. So that is what basically I thought. But otherwise, it's very beautifully done question paper. Especially, I'm impressed with the CO that you have formulated. So that's all from my side, Dr. Aziz.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Dr. Vijay. I'm sure, Dr. Praveen, the whatsoever inputs have been given by Dr. Vijay, you'll be taking those inputs very positively. I would also reiterate that you have put in a lot of effort. It is absolutely great to see such wonderfully prepared CEOs. And then you have made an excellent effort to align those all the questions with the respective PIs as well as Bloom's taxonomy levels. It's a wonderfully done job. And I'm sure together, collectively, we'll keep on improving. And then, as I told in yesterday's session as well, that within very near future, so we'll be able to implement all the examination reforms in our whole academic fraternity as well. It's a wonderful vision of AICT as well. But very great, very good work, Dr. Praveen Kumar. Right.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you,
Professor Jadhav. Yeah. I can stop sharing now.
Yeah. And next in line, I had.
Thank you very much for the.
Yeah. Aviral Awasthi had shown some interest to present his paper. So we have already made him the panelist. Aviral Awasthi. May I request Aviral Awasthi to kindly share his screen and present his paper. Aviral. I think it's not close to his screen. Not able to unmute also. Dr. Shruti Narayanan, we have made her also the panelist. We did that earlier. And Dr. Shankarmurthy AG also. Dr. Shankarmurthy, have you been able to resolve your audio problem? Because we were able to see your question paper, we were able to see you also, but we're not able to hear you. So if your microphone problem has been resolved, then we'd like to see that paper again. Dr. Shankarmurthy, we'll make just another attempt with you. No, it's not coming. Okay, then I would select somebody else who has raised hand. Jitinder Pal Singh Chaddha, can we, my request to IT team, can we make Jitinder Pal Singh, Professor Jitinder Pal Singh Chaddha as the panelist, please? Professor Jitinder, you have been made the panelist. You just raise your hand. For a couple of seconds, Professor Jitinder Pal Singh Chaddha, are you there? In the meantime, Professor Shivani, if I could request you, because as we decided, you must be having some sample question papers with you, if you'd like to go for explaining the same.
Yeah, sure, Dr. Rajneesh. I would like to share a rubric rather this time, you know.
You can take that opportunity. And in the meantime, we would align few more participants who would be working to show their papers.
Sure. In the meanwhile, while the participants write, they share their screen with the question paper. Let me share a sample rubric. Right. Yeah, I hope my screen is visible, Dr. Rajneesh.
Yeah, it is very clearly visible. You're clearly audible as well. Please go ahead.
So see, we have been talking about, you know, that it's very important to frame a good question paper. But along with that, we should also provide a rubric for same, right? So in yesterday's discussion, right, all four of us, what we talked about was that there has to be a rubric, and rubric is possible even for, you know, the end term examination, but then we need to choose for what sort of rubric, right, should be provided to the students, right, in order to clearly see for, clearly tell them what is our expectation and how they'll be graded. So the rubric that I'm showing you here is for the lab experiment report. Right. And this one is an analytic rubric. Right. So while we evaluate our students for, you know, the lab performances, lab report is one of the major component of our evaluation. Right. So here we have an analytic rubric, which defines what exactly are we expecting in the lab reports. Generally, what we say to the student is that the lab report, this seems to be copied, exactly same language as what they are pouring into the lab reports, right? And at times we say, okay, the lab report is not the one that was expected, but then we should be clear about what expectations are we setting from our students, right? So here is the criteria. First of all, we need to define the criteria on the basis of which that lab report should be evaluated and should be made, right? So it is aim and introduction is the most important part of any of the report that we generally give. Then is the experiment completed and the result obtained is the second criteria that we have taken. Then reporting of the results, how the students are exactly reporting the results, uncertainties and the discussion about the result, which is a missing factor in our reports if we'll generally see, if we'll move on to the traditional teaching learning method. our students are not in a habit to discuss the results in their lab reports. They simply write the results, they conclude it in one line, and the conclusion is almost similar to the aim. And then the skills, the language in which that report is presented, that is the English expression, the overall score. Suppose if this overall report is out of 20, right? So each criteria holds a weightage of 4 marks. And when are we going to give the 4 marks? These are the descriptors in between, which defines each criteria. That the criteria one, that is aim and introduction, that is the report title, session date, name of the student in the team, are noted in report heading. Report cites full score reference used in the session work. And for writing, the report background noting relevant pages, the report method is there. And the report includes the step taken by the team to manage the task in the entire experiment. So while we are to evaluate a group, you know, at times it becomes so difficult, right? So that how to evaluate each and every candidate in the group. So these rubrics, they help us in that way also. So here we are giving our expectations and we are telling the students. So the descriptor under 4 marks is tell what is exactly expected. And the descriptor under marks 3, 2, 1, and 0, they tells about the deviation from that, what was expected from it, right? So if, suppose if in like 3 mark category, right, when the student for the same criteria is gonna mark less than the 4 marks one, right, the 3 marks. So when the report is partially completed, right, but is still acceptable, in that case, the title, session dates, name, student team, exactly same as in case of 4 marks. Report is cited, references are there in the report, right? The background is there. Report methods are partially completed, but then it is not gonna hinder, it shouldn't hinder the reader. And then what exactly the report is telling about is really clear while a reader or a tutor is evaluating it. In that case, the student is going to score 3 marks. If I move on to mark 1, incomplete, the aim and introduction, and with just sketchy details, you know, that will lead him to 1 mark. In this way, for all the criterias, you know, we can have clear descriptors which are going to help the student at least to attain all the learning outcomes. What we intend to say using the rubric is what we are expecting actually from a student to perform in a particular task, right, should be very clearly cited through rubric. In this way, he'll be able to work effectively. He'll be able to self-evaluate himself even while doing his own work, right? So self-evaluation is the most important thing that we need to inculcate in today's student, in today's generation, because this is what exactly the industry is also expecting from them while they graduate out of any of the university. So I hope I'm able to make the vision behind the rubric clear, why exactly a rubric is required. And even for a thing like evaluating labs, right? The lab report, which is one of the component of it, we should clearly define a rubric even for a lab report.
Yeah, that's great, Dr. Shivani. I'm very sure the participants would definitely get a very clear idea that to what minutest extent as well the evaluation components and the learning of the students can be mapped so that as examiners or as their academician teachers, we don't miss anything on knowing this thing, that what actually they have been able to learn and what they have not been able to learn, and whatsoever they have not been able to learn, we can always put in our effort to further insist upon, make more efforts to make them learn that particular aspect as well. This is wonderfully done, I'm sure. So this, in this short description of around say a couple of minutes, I'm sure participants would be able to see this, that to these kind of details also rubrics for evaluation can be mapped, right? We'll go next, because a lot of participants are currently waiting to present their papers. We'll go next with Aviral Awasthi. Professor Aviral Awasthi, please. You just confirm that you are ready with for showing your paper. Professor Aviral Vasti. Please share your screen, Professor Aviral Vasti. Yeah, we are able to see your screen. Yep. Yeah, it would be good if you could switch on your camera. If not, then that's absolutely all right, Professor Aviral. But we would definitely like to hear you. Professor Aviral, so we are able to see your screen, but we are not able to hear you. That's the unfortunate part. Professor Aviral, we'll just wait for a couple of more seconds. Or what you can do is maybe you can just scroll through, scroll down to show your question paper to all the participants. Just scroll down so that at least we can have a look at your question paper, what you have done. Okay, yeah, please keep on scrolling down. Okay, yeah, we are able to see the, keep on scrolling down, please. So what we're able to see is Professor Viral Avasthi is from Allen House Institute of Technology, Kanpur. Professor Shivani, although we are not able to listen from him, could you just quickly pass on the comments? Professor Viral, I request you to kindly go to the top of your question paper. And Professor Shivani would be able to give some quick comments about your question paper, how it could have been further improved upon.
Yeah, sure. Thank you, Dr. Rajneesh. Yeah, Professor Aviral, first of all, right, this is just a suggestion. The course outcomes that you have listed for your particular course, they seems to be more of course objectives, right? First of all, the thing is that we need to distinguish what are objectives and what are outcomes. When we say course outcomes, it is like what the student will be capable of doing after the completion of the course, right? So a little bit of detailing is required in this case. I think that what we understood of objective and what are real outcomes, right? We really need to think them properly, and modification is required in this case. Like the first outcome, if I talk about it, is to develop simple algorithm for this arithmetic and logical problems, right? It is an objective that what is the objective of this course, right? To teach students to develop simple algorithms for arithmetic and logical problems. We need to transform it into an outcome that after learning this objective, right, after the completion of this objective, what student will be capable of doing, right, from these algorithms for arithmetic and logical problems. Maybe he'll be able to design the algo for these type of problems. Right, that is what we need to check for, and that is how we need to design our course outcomes. Can you just scroll your paper, please? See, the questions that we see here are very direct questions, you know, define difference between OBJ and EXE files, right, and explain. Two mark remembering standard question, we are asking him to differentiate and then to further explain. There has to be a little bit more clarity, right, in our questions, because our question reflects our expectations from the students. What we want exactly him to explain while differentiating these two. List the various components of C language, Right. So, see, these seems to be plain direct questions. And, you know, these questions would be similar to, right, any of the question paper, if we look from the past, like these type of questions would definitely be there. We need to frame the questions in such a way that that our students get a motivation to really answer them. They should really look for what is going to come in the question paper that, you know, that will be really different. And they are really sensitizing, you know, their gray cells, taking their gray cells in order to answer those questions. Right. So in the entire paper, if we look at, we have terms like define it, list this, describe it, interpret. Right. Interpret iteration and recursions in terms of what? Right. That is, more defining of questions is required in this question paper.
Professor Shivani, I would just like to interrupt here. Professor Abhiral has written in the chat window that this is for first year course. Now you can give your comments while keeping in mind this version of the statement also. Whether it's for first year course or second year course, whatsoever it is, we strongly feel that any question paper could be made application-oriented question paper based on more of real-life examples. So please simultaneously take his version also in your purview when you are explaining this thing to him. Right?
See, sir, even if it is a first-year question paper, you know, right, the subject, that is just the subject that we are teaching in first year. That will be definitely a basic subject. But even if it is a basic subject, the way we are framing a question, right, that I think that can be application oriented, because those are the starting years when we are making our student to work like that, right? So it is not like whether it is first year, second year, third year or fourth year, but yes, what can be there is that the number of application based questions, if you think it is a first year student, they are the first year students, and it will be too early for them to appear in such type of, you know, subjects with such type of questions. In that case, at least we can have some lesser number of questions application based, but then they have to be there in a question paper if a question paper has to be balanced. Without an application based question, right, that applying and analyzing part, I don't think so we'll be able to evaluate the students at that Bloom's level. Similarly, as you have seen that you have given a question part 3, describe else if letter with switch case with example, right? So that analysis, what sort of analysis is required in that? If you can a little bit elaborate over it. I think there is some problem with sir's microphone, right? That's why he's not able to speak.
Yeah, right? He's not able to. We are not able to hear him.
Yeah.
The major, so we can go on. Yeah, we can just.
Yeah. The major intent behind this workshop was to really make our student do what we expect from them, irrespective of year in which they are. We are to begin from the very first year itself. Right. And we need to look for what we are expecting from the students, and the clarity should be there in the question as what we are asking from the students. Right. A question like we shouldn't go on the limited number of words while we are framing a question paper. In that case, we need to elaborate a question, because that elaboration is going to give the student is going to tell the students what is being expected from that question. And I think we'll be able to evaluate more effectively if we'll frame a question in a better way.
Yeah, very good. Thanks a lot, Professor Shivani. So a couple of things which I would like to add to this, as Dr. Archana earlier told also, it was there in yesterday's sessions as well. See, the question paper has to be more lively. It is not supposed to be boring, more lively in terms of including more real life examples, more graphs, more figures, more some pictures which should actually excite the student while attempting that question also. And see, whether it's a first year course or second year course or final year course, as Professor Shivani also told, every course has got some real life application. And if we are able to align our questions asked in the question paper with some real life problems, that would be really great. Whether it is remembering level or understanding level, every question can be aligned with some real life examples. Right. So that's what the humble suggestion here would be. Otherwise, wonderfully done job. I'm sure we all have got a lot to learn, and that is how we'll keep on improving as well as academicians, as teachers. Right. Okay. Next in queue is, and there has been absolutely enthusiastic participation from all the attendees. We do have close to 900 participants in the session as of now. Right. And so we'll continue with this session up to around 1 p.m. And we'll keep on simultaneously showing in the Professor Shivani. In the meanwhile, I would request you to be ready with explaining one more sample question paper as well from our side. Right. I'm sure we'll be having in our question bank. And in the meantime, I would request another participant, Professor Sarita has been made the panelist.
Professor Sarita. Yes, sir. Very good morning to everyone. I'm just presenting now. I'm sharing.
We are able to listen to you very clearly.
Thank you, sir.
That has been a little bit of technical problem from the other participant side that we have not been able to listen to.
I think you can see me also now.
Yeah. We are able to see you very clearly. So as requested earlier by our VC ma'am as well, and if you could give us some feedback about this workshop, how we could improve upon in future also, and whether this workshop has made any kind of difference for you as an attendee, and you seem to be a very senior person in your organization.
Yeah, I'm a gray hair.
the knowledge which you would be gaining in this workshop, you would be definitely like to pass it on to all your other colleagues in your organization also. So we are all ears to listen to your feedback and then have a look at your question paper and your demonstration of the question paper. Yeah, over to you.
Namaste, and thank you for the opportunity provided. These 2 days, the last yesterday and today, was absolutely wonderful. I did have a lot of work, but I could just not take myself away from 10:30 to 2:30. I would like to first thank the Vice Chancellor, Dr. Archana, and all the other Dr. Rajneesh, Dr. I think, sir,
Dr.
can
Vijay,
you just...
Dr.
Yes,
Vijay,
Dr. Vijay, and Madam Professor also. Shivani. Yes, Professor Shivani. So absolutely wonderful to listen to them. I was blown away by the first talk, and madam, you are absolutely wonderful in the way that you've projected. And I enjoyed the talk yesterday where I could actually see how the mapping has to be done. There are so many misunderstandings that we have and things that we think we know, but then probably we are not aligned in the right way. So that alignment was done. Thank you for that. Extremely impressed. I'm from B&M Institute of Technology, which is in Bangalore. And what I would like to share is we are affiliated to VTU. We have currently become autonomous. So for me, it's very important to understand these exam reforms because we need to get them into our system, and we have more flexibility to do so now. So that was one thing. So semester end exams used to be held by the university, but now we have the right to do that. So it's very important. We will be training our staff with this. So whatever I have attended and I have seen and I've heard about Chitkara University also, it's absolutely wonderful. And that's what I got as a feedback. The way the question papers have to be set, the way you have to align your questions, the freedom given to the staff to take care of how you make your paper look like, because I understand that, yes, it should be more interactive. And yes, it's just not the end semester examination, but you have also said the importance of the continuous evaluation and how to make it more interesting. I totally understand that concept, because children now would like to be happy when they look at the paper and happy to answer a paper rather than look at it with difficulty. So that's yes, sir, very good. And there was one thing that I did implement during what I used to teach. I actually head the placement department, but I do take up a course. So there is something called a peer evaluation that we had done. And I believe that that's also a very important way to examine or to evaluate children and the way
Sarita, I would have really not liked to interrupt you because you have explaining it so well. No.
Yes.
But we do have the pleasure of welcoming AICT Vice Chairman Honorable Professor Punia in the session also. Yes. So I would request the IT team to kindly elevate him to the panelist. Professor Punia, please.
Please go on.
I wanted to make a request to the or IT team to. Because he might have joined as an attendee elevate him to the panelist.
So I'll keep it short.
Please go on.
I'll keep it short then. Yes.
No. Please go on. No. We'd like to hear it from you.
Thank you, Dr. Rajneesh. So welcome, sir, and namaste. And what I did find was peer evaluation was one thing that I have been taking up with my course. And I find that when a group of students try to evaluate another set of students on a project, usually I give them a set of a code to do or a game to design, and they do it using Java because that's what I have asked them to do. And there's a lot of exuberance and there's fun component for the child. And I think that's extremely important that students feel happy and get involved. That's when they actually learn. So that's my perspective. And collaborative projects, like giving them even mini projects where they talk to one another, talk to another group and tell the other group, this is what you have to do or you can do, makes a lot of difference. So I believe that's important also. So that's about it. And that's what I learned. And I learned so much and I have to go back, reiterate on a lot of slides also that I have photocopied actually. And just taking a screenshot because I would like to read through it again and understand it more better. So if we do have questions, I hope that I can come back to you all and ask for any clarifications when you people have time for it also. Yeah.
Absolutely. We would be more
Thank
than
you. Thank you, sir. So the paper that I have done a mistake here. It's not an end semester paper. It's more of a in-between paper. So kindly forgive me for that. But I hope that I'm able to show what I've done. So this is, again, for a second year student, but yes, the first question is, when you're giving feedback to other people, I was also taking it. Yes, the first question seems to be very direct. And I've just put it the remembering phase itself. That's what I put. The second one is where, this is one thing I find important that my students have to do in coding is they should be able to dry run a code. It's not executed directly on a system. They should also know how it happens step by step. So that's the reason I give this kind of question. So that's at analyzing level. So there are only two COs addressed here because I have not done it as an end semester exam. I have connected to performance indicators. Now, connecting it to a performance indicator is something new to me. So I've used to just connect it directly to the PO, but I believe that performance indicators and competency attributes, the CAs that are given, that's extremely helpful for a teacher or a course teacher to connect to how the assessment should be for the course that they take. So I believe that's an excellent thing that was shared with us. So what I've done is an internal choice. So the student will take either 1A, 1B or 2A, 2B. So this is how we have done here. And you'll also see that, I think I can reduce the page size. Is this okay? This is more better, it's not, yeah.
No, earlier so, one was more better.
Better, okay, 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 okay. Then you'll also see it maps to the same COs and the same level. We have not changed it. It's just a different set of questions. That's it. And different kind of a code that the student would like to answer. So this is how we've kept this. And here is one where I asked the student to, not a direct question. I've asked him to tell me how he would actually use multiple level inheritance, but instead of asking him directly, I have done this. So they will write the snippet of code. So it's very important that the child also knows the syntax, et cetera, which is, since I'm also in the placement as a placement head. So I believe that, able to write down a code is extremely important for them, or at least the pseudo code of that. So I put that up. And this is again, I am sure that you will not find this very good. I am feeling that too now. So I'm directly asking them to implement a stack program would not be a right thing to do. This is alternated with this. So here where I ask a student, instead of telling him to differentiate between, it's simple overriding and overloading, they have to differentiate it. But then instead of asking him like that, so I've said, when would they actually be using it? That's the reason I have put up this and said that this is, as a programmer, when would you go to overload a function or override a function? So I have given them this option. There's this one where, simple constructs have to be understood by the students and I need to check if they have followed it. Now, if for is something they know, what's different in Java is for each. So we have I have asked them to do this particular problem. And instead of asking them directly about exceptions, giving them a small part where I said that everything goes wrong, then what you would do is you have alternate, so you have a way to handle those problems. So how does Java do it? So that's asking about exceptions instead of telling them write about try, catch, and how do you actually do it in case you want to program it. So this is one question that will connect to them. So I have put that at analyzing level. I would like a feedback if that would be the right way to do it. I have also given another problem for them. Here, this is more about, instead of telling them, give me a problem on inheritance or using inheritance, I have actually told them that there are something that students like. So there's a car and a multi-utility vehicle, and then you have the SUVs, which is like a combination of both. So ask them how they would actually want to put those properties across and show it as a snippet of code for inheritance. So this is, again, it could be a direct question, but I believe that they have to think and then see which are the different functions, et cetera, that need to be there. The question here is, again, about exception, though it looks direct, it's actually not, because they should have to know how to handle this, but they have to write their own exception here. So they need to write a class for exception, which they should know to put in. So that's why this is there. This looks as very simple, but they need to write a code, write a class, see how they can handle this when the user will give the input lesser than 85. So the last 7A, 7 and 8 are a little bit on understanding and remembering itself. They're very direct, but it does help them to understand the concepts, which in the next test that I would have given them, I would have asked more questions on these. They are touching more of the exception part and then the garbage collector. So that's what we see here. This is, though it's compared, still understanding, nothing more than that. They're just looking at checked exceptions and unchecked exceptions. And the last one is very direct. Yes. Now I feel that there are some things I need to change in this. After I listened to a lot of feedback, I was a little hesitant to present this paper because I can see the loopholes and things that I should change. So that's why I was a little hesitant to raise my hand, but I'm open to a lot of critique. Thank you. I know that'll come, sir. Yeah.
this is the beauty of this session. This is the beauty, the way these sessions have been actually planned by AICT. We are following that scheme, because when you see other people's question papers and listen to the feedbacks being given to them, you automatically try to learn so many things, right? That this is actually wonderful. But before, I would request Professor Vijay to give his comments on the question paper. But we do have, as I told earlier also, Professor Punia among us, Vice Chairman of AICT. I would request Professor Punia to kindly bless this workshop with your words of wisdom.
Rajanishji, please continue. It's very interesting. I'm enjoying, I'm listening. And in the end, and whatever suggestions will be there, certainly we'll discuss. Just one or two points here, when understanding level and remembering we are discussing, something we are putting explain like this one, no?
Yeah.
And their marks which are given 4. So when explanation, there has to be some boundaries for even for asking for explanation. Someone may explain in some 5 lines, someone may explain in 2 pages, someone may explain in some 5 pages.
Yes.
So while we are setting these equations, in fact, some boundaries we'll have to fix. Otherwise, what happens, suppose you have set the question paper and you are assessing those answer sheets also, you are knowing that what exactly you are expecting. Mm-hmm. But many a time, students, they are challenging our decisions. They are going for re-evaluation. Mm-hmm. So with another teacher, when it is going, his thinking, his perception may be something different. So for same answer, you may have given some 3 out of 4. Another one may be giving 1 only, because no boundaries we have fixed here.
Yes.
So while we are designing the question, there has to be clarity that what sort of answer, in fact, you are expecting. Otherwise, the levels which you have defined and the type of questions which you are putting, particularly at the level of analysis, it's wonderful. It's very good. So students are, in fact, they are forced to think. That way, it's very good.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, I will follow you. You have got feedback from none other than Professor.
I know. Pina. I am actually very blessed. Thank you.
So, yes. Okay, Professor Vijay. So, I would request you to kindly share your feedback about this question paper. Professor Sarita is already told that she knows that she is going to get a lot of criticism. So, Professor Sarita, it's not criticism. We all are here to learn. That's what the whole intent behind this workshop has been, right? So, Professor Vijay, yeah, please.
Thank you, Dr. Rajneesh, and welcome Dr. Punia in this workshop, or especially in this last session. It's very informative, and you have already given your feedback on this. So can I see the course outcome. Basically, that is
what I have given. Yes. Only two I have given. Yes.
That is the most important part of this OBE that I emphasize it a lot whenever I take session on OBE, because yes. That is the most important task, and most of the course outcome that I see, they are not in line with how they should be.
Yes, sir. So these are usually supplied, given to us from the university. Yes,
also,
so we will be changing this. Yes.
Yeah, so I suppose you can understand that we have to change these course outcome, and they has to be in line with the Bloom taxonomy. And it should not be content oriented. It should be rather the outcome oriented. And the outcome oriented in terms of Bloom taxonomy. We should use the Bloom taxonomy verbs for putting the course outcome, especially, or whatever the course it may be. Again, with one disclaimer that I am not from the computer science background, so I may not critically evaluate your questions, but the things which are as generally clear, that is, you can scroll up, you can scroll down further. I want to see the summary. Yeah, CO1, CO2 is 40 and 60% the level summary.
This is the one, sir.
Yeah. Just see the level summary as I have already given my suggestions in my previous, you can say, discussion on this question paper. That is, it should not be more than 15%, you can say, weightage given to remembering and understanding collectively together. And rather, what I would suggest, if you want to produce good engineer, then the remembering may be avoided, because understanding already include remembering. So as far as my personal opinion is concerned, the remembering part is to be avoided from all type of question paper, whether it is computer science oriented or any other, because if someone who can understand and answer the questions which are at understanding level, certainly it can be done only if the remembering is there. So remembering means when we write remembering type of question, we certainly have to have what is this, list this and that. So these are very straightforward, and they basically should not be part of the question paper. And as already been, you can say, emphasized by Professor Mantri, Dr. Rajneesh as well, and Shivani as well. So that is the straightforward question will only come when we generally give the remembering type of question. So now we can come to the questions. Professor Punia has already given the insight into the, you can say, boundary that we should set. But at the same time, we should also give some questions which test the student, how they set their own boundary, keeping in mind the marks that has been allotted to a particular question. So as a thumb rule, if it is 60 marks question paper, for example, for 3 hours, then approximately it's about 3 minutes for 1 mark. So accordingly, if it is 1.5 hours question, suppose a question paper that this in this particular case, then again, it is approximately 3 minutes for one question, and accordingly, the things you can say when you are giving marks and you are designing questions. So that particular thumb rule you should take care of, that if that again depends, it's not always that it is 3 minute, 1 marks, that depends on what is the total number of marks that you are assessing a student from, and what is the time duration that you are allowing student to answer those things. So for this 30 marks question, this test assessment for 1.5 hour, then it comes about 3 minutes a question. And that question was basically raised in queries as well. When I was going through the queries of my session, So that is the thumb rule that you can decide how many question, how much marks to be allotted to a question. That is basically depending on how much time it's going to take. Again, this explain is, I suppose when we are explaining something, this explanation can only be done if we remember something, and then it is I suppose it is understanding level question as far as my understanding is concerned of this Bloom taxonomy. So remembering is straightforward. You are putting or rewriting something as it is, and you can explain if you remember and understand the concept. So that is what basically, and again, this performance indicator is, I suppose, not, it is mismatched, because when, if I go through the AICT reform policy, again, with this disclaimer that AICT has given the competencies and performance indicators as suggestive and indicative. We can design our own, or we can add or modify or tweak these competencies and the performance indicator depending on our course curriculum and the program or the course that we have designed and how we are evaluating. So if you do not find any performance indicator in the list of the suggestive or the document that is released by AICT, we can add our own this performance indicator or competency. So that is what I am repeating again and again, that these are suggestive and indicative. We can tweak those performance indicator and competencies, and that has been introduced just to map the things clearly with proper clarity. But if we are not designing our course outcome properly, then it is difficult to map with PO as well as the performance indicator. So again, reiterating that everything should go hand in hand. There is nothing can be, you can say, designed as far as the OBE concerned in isolation. We have to start with program outcome, and then again, we have to go come down. The second question, if you see part B, that is also of, you have written, this is of analyzing level, that is what basically you have inspect the following code and write the output. So how do you think that it is of analyzing level?
So the student will have to actually do a dry run of that particular code, and they have to evaluate. They'll have to actually put it out in bits, and it's a bitwise operator. So they have a lot of work to do. And at the end of it, they should know how each of those bits, how do those operators work. They should be aware of that.
Let me give my viewpoint on any, you can say, program. If we are giving some program as it is, and we are writing or asking a student to give the output, then it means what I suppose I'm asking them to apply your knowledge, and then that application on the formula or the statement or the syntax that you have given, they have to apply the concept on the statement or the syntax, and then they will get the output. Analyzing is something else, that is basically for the bigger problems. If you have given some statement kind of thing, they have to put them, basically break them into different portions, analyze them, and then write something. That is the analysis type of problem. Here they have to apply this knowledge of syntax. And then if they understand that syntax, then only they can apply, and then only they can get the output. That is what my perception of the programming is. Whatever little bit programming I know, and whatever you can say understanding of Bloom taxonomy, that is what my perception is. I suppose you understood my
yes, I did, sir. Right.
So yes. They have to apply their knowledge. It's not basically they have to analyze something. So that is what basically you can go through your question paper thoroughly, and then we can fix the thing. The performance indicator is the most important. And the otherwise, at the top, it is the course outcome, which I generally basically give my thumbs up, that if we are designing our course outcome properly, the things mapping is very, very easy. Then it is not difficult. If we are not designing course outcome or formulating course outcome properly, simply writing from the content that is there in the syllabus, then the things will be difficult. It is not possible for mapping the Bloom taxonomy level as well as the performance indicator there. Thank you. Thanks. That's all from myself.
Professor Sarita, let me tell you, although Professor Vijay is a very humble person, he will keep on saying this thing that whatsoever little bit I know about Bloom's taxonomy or whatsever little bit I know
sir,
about
Sir, I am not fooled by that, no, sir. No. I know.
Whatsoever a little bit know about the programming, but he is the one who has taken a lot of initiative in getting it implemented in Chittara University as well, along with Dr. Archana Mantri. Yes. And simultaneously, he himself single-handedly has built a kind of educational ERP software as well. So he is very well versed of all these concepts, but it is humbleness that he makes these kind of statements. But otherwise, I'm sure he knows the subject quite well, right? I'm sure, Professor Sarita, you must
Thank
have
you.
Got benefited
Thank
so
you,
as our other participants
yes.
also. We
yes.
do have a lot of other people also still raising
yes.
hand and writing in QA and that they want to present their question papers. So we'll go with one more participant, Professor
can
Neeta Shiv Kumar. Yeah, you can please
Thank
stop
you. Thank you so much. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, sir. We'll go with one more participant, Professor Neeta Shiv Kumar. She had shown interest to present her paper. And then
yes.
I would request in the meantime, Professor Shivani, you may be ready that as we discussed, you would like to show a first year paper as well, because earlier we told that how the first year paper can be framed. So first year paper may be of basic electronics, which you can show to the participants that how it can be aligned with different levels of Bloom's taxonomy and how it can be made more of application oriented also.
Sure, Dr. Rajneesh.
Professor Neeta, could you please share
yes,
your
sir.
Screen?
Yes, sir. So it's
a biotechnology paper, yeah. Professor Neeta,
yes,
if you could switch on your camera, we are able to see your paper very clearly. We are able to listen to you also.
Sure, sir. Sure. I'm not able to...
Yeah, we are able to see you also. Good.
On my...
Yeah, we are able to see the screen. Everything is fine.
Yeah.
Please go ahead.
Good afternoon.
Please start with your kind feedback about the part, about this workshop as well. About the whole effort being put in by AICT as well as... By our team also. So what has been your feedback?
Sure, sir. Thank you all for giving me this opportunity for presenting my question paper. I have been into this teaching and research from last 15 years. So we have been into this NBA thing, like say with respect to this examination reforms, particularly with the Bloom's taxonomy and the performance indicators. But yes, performance through this workshop, eye-opening to me was the performance indicator. So not much efforts I have put up here in my paper for this particular task, but the other things we have been doing so, and I would be very happy that if you could tell me that whatever are the loopholes in my paper, so that I myself and my other colleagues know, I could pass it on to other colleagues of my department, and we could bring the changes in our curriculum.
Yeah, which institute do you come from, Professor Neeta?
If you can just, I will scroll through my paper. I am from RV College of Engineering, sir,
yeah.
Bangalore.
RV College of Engineering, Bangalore. Okay, very, very reputed institute.
Yeah, I am faculty from Department of Biotechnology. So
any
the
feedback,
paper what I have shared
Professor Neeta,
is the
Professor Neeta,
online.
Any feedback?
Yes,
sorry.
Certainly.
Any feedback you would like to share with us to make this workshop contents even better on the delivery participant? How has been your experience of attending this workshop, because you have invested a lot of time
this was really wonderful, sir, because this was a really wonderful experience tackling and understanding each and every concept. So this is really a good workshop, and a lot of inputs I could get from your end also. All the resource persons were really wonderful. And I would like to congratulate all of you, because it's really a successful one. Because as personally myself, I could actually get into the details of each and everything, starting from
the levels of scoring each and every question to Bloom's taxonomy, to performance indicators, as well as rubrics and whatever. I was very much interested and influenced by the rubrics given by Dr. Shivani, wherein the different levels what she gave 1 hour before. I will show you in my paper also, we do with the keys, because keys, we usually give it for the CIE when we do continuous internal evaluation. We give keys, I will show you in my paper also, but not the bifurcations. What I found interesting was, that is what I need to implement when I finish up this workshop. I take up from this workshop. So this is really wonderful, sir. Yeah. Thank you for this wonderful workshop. Yeah. I will share my paper, sir. Shall I share it?
Yeah, please, please. The paper is already shared. We are able to see it on the screen. And I'm very glad to see you have clearly mentioned at the top of this. This is a closed book paper, because there is another interesting concept of open book as well. Perhaps you would like to cover that in upcoming workshops as well. It's a closed book paper, so you're very clearly mentioned. Very good. Yeah, please go on.
Yeah. So the first question, as you can see, that it's we are directly coming to level 5, because this is actually a common course which we offer at the college level, biology for engineers. And through biology for engineers, we actually would like to make the students aware about the principles of biology and how they can adopt these principles into the engineering principles or the work. So the first question is, as you can see, that it is an question which is asking how this course would actually give them an overview of the biological principles that has served as a source of for inspiring innovations. So we have asked this open-ended question, which is of the level of 5, BTL 5, and the fourth CO has been met here. As I said, I have not worked much with the performance indicators, but yes, I have given a try. I think there may be some here and there hiccups here in PIs, so bear with me. And coming to the next question, so this is a question of level 2 and 3, because it involves both identification as well as, giving a certain understanding of the biomolecule, whatever is being put up here. So this is the structure of a cellulose, and we are asking them to identify it and as well as explain it. So it is both 2 and 3, sir. And it is mapping with the CO1 of our this course outcome. And next, coming to the third question, here you can see that we again are putting up a diagram and asking them to explain what it is. So this is a basic understanding question. So it complies to BTL2, level 2, and it is mapping with our CO1. Since this is the first unit test, so most of our questions, they are mapping with CO1 and CO2. CO3 and CO4 would actually, we will meet it in the next coming tests. So in this paper, you can see that this is just, we are mapping with, we are actually meeting with the CO1 and CO2. Then coming to the fourth question, am I audible? Yeah.
Yeah, you are clearly audible. Please go on.
Yes. Yeah. The fourth question is basically, it's something to do with the problem solving. Which we actually, in genetics and all, we give some problem solving questions. So this is the fourth question is, meeting up with the BTL level 3, and it is meeting with the CO2, mapping with CO2. And the fifth question is, it is mainly based on investigating how the entire process happens. So this is meeting with the level 4, and this is being mapped with our CO2, course outcome 2. So as much as possible, we are taking care that we meet all the BTLs, at least up to 4 and 5. So, but in this workshop, I could see that it was told that in the CIE level, we can meet, you know, we can go up to CO4, but somehow we are trying to give even up to BTL level 5. And you can see that we are not asking any questions on BTL level 1, because BTL level 1, we usually take care in our quizzes. So quizzes will take care for BTL 1, whereas 2 to 5, we are taking care in the in our CIE, in our question papers, internal question papers. And BTL 6, we would take care in terms of our self-experiential learning or self-learning, what we are conducting for the students through assignments, through their presentations and all. We are actually taking care of BTL level 5 and 6. So this is how we have planned, and we are putting up the things to meet 1 to 6 levels of BTL. And then coming to the weightage, this is, since it is a CIE paper, so you can see that CO1 and CO2, it's like 48 and 28. As you have mentioned, 40, 40 and 20, that is 1 and 2, we have to cover up to 40%, 2, 3 and 4, we have to cover up to 40%, and 5 and 6, another 20%. But that we are taking care only in the semester and examination, whereas in internals, we are trying to make it 50-50 or say 60-40 like that. So this is the weightage and the marks as aligned with the COs and the BTLs. So this is the keys, actually, what Dr. Shivani was mentioning. This is the keys what we give to the students for that particular exam. And we expect them to put up these.
Very good.
Yes, answers.
So this is the answer key, yeah.
Yeah,
actually, it is felt that if possible, if the university rules permit or the organization rules permit, after the conduct of the examination, a model solution should always be made available to the students, so that they get to know. What exactly the examiner was expecting from that particular question paper when he or she set the question paper. Ideally, it should be done. So I'm very glad to see that you have prepared the key also, along with the question paper also. This is very good.
Yes. Right? So this is from my end, sir. I would like your feedback.
Maybe I only would be taking this question paper. See, a couple of things. First of all, the layout of the question paper is very impressive. You have, I don't know whether it is, again, by instruction from the college that the question paper is required to be printed on the letterhead, or you decided to do that.
No, this is from our college side, sir. Every question paper will be of the same format.
That's good. I feel, first of all, the good points are the questions are very elaborative, and question paper doesn't seem to be boring. This is what we have been telling in all earlier sessions as well, that there are diagrams and all the questions are elaborative. Likewise, if I read the question number, say, 4, it says, when a pure breeding brown cat is mated to pure breeding cat, all the kittens are born brown. What results would you expect when an F1 brown kitten is mated with this? 3 options. If I read the question number 5, again it is written, proteins are very important for functioning of our body. Now, I take this first statement as a kind of learning statement also. This is what was told in one of the sessions as well, that the question paper should be such that the student feels like that after attempting the question paper also, he has learned something, right? So this first statement is like, it's a kind of learning statement, that proteins are very important for functioning of our body. They are synthesized in the body based on the information present on the DNA. Now in the first 2 statements, actually there is no question. it is a kind of revision for the students. Again, while reading the question paper also, he's getting to learn something. Then the question starts actually, which says, investigate on how proteins are synthesized. I love these kind of questions. The questions which are actually elaborate instead of simply, otherwise this question could have been simply asked like this only. Investigate on how proteins are synthesized. This question could have been asked like that only, but that is not a good practice at all. Many a times our faculty members, co-faculty members do this. They will be trying to be very, very short on the statement of the question there. So here the suggestion would be the questions have to be elaborative in nature, which is getting very clearly reflected in this question paper as well. These could have been even more elaborative as well, but then whatever has been done, that is absolutely fine. My particular feedback, Professor Deeta, is related to question number one. That when you say this question, which is a general question where you are trying to assess the learning of the student on the almost of the whole course, because this is what we are saying. Biology for engineers is an introductory course to give an overview of biological principles that has served as a source of inspiring innovations. Justify the statement by giving examples. Now, you have decided to put this question on Bloom's taxonomy level number 5, which is evaluate actually. Right? Bloom's taxonomy level number 5 is evaluate. Although we keep on saying this thing, this is usually comes in our discussions as well, that the teaching is more of a philosophy. Everybody will be having a different opinion about a particular aspect of concept, particular aspect of teaching, particular aspect of assessment as well. But here, very politely, I would like to completely disagree. I'm not sure that how does it this question fit into the evaluate level of Bloom's taxonomy. It is more of a descriptive question. So, and where we are trying to ask the student about means what is his general perception about this particular course. So this is not evaluate. And if you remember in yesterday's session, which I had delivered, we had clearly shown some of the questions which should be ideally fitted in the evaluate. Evaluate is in fact very high level of assessment learning. And in one of the slides, we're told that although there is a overlap between analyzing and applying, these top two levels usually cannot be assessed with these kind of questions. We had said that there are internship opportunities and projects, seminars. Higher level of learning are usually tested when the student undergoes those kind of experiences. So this question definitely, I'm personally quite sure about that this cannot be fitted into Bloom's taxonomy level number 5. All other questions are reasonably okay to be at levels, whatsoever level you have chosen them to be. Could we go on to question number 5, please? Again, you have decided to keep this question at Bloom's taxonomy number level 4, which is applying. But I don't see any application again here of this particular, because as I told you, this question could have been asked, which would not have been good, simply like this as well, investigate on how proteins are synthesized. Or in other words, perhaps I could have asked this thing as well, write a short note on your understanding about how proteins are synthesized. This could also have been the question. So this is what exactly you are trying to ask in this question. And when we say that you are basically asking him to write a short note on, right, then it is not applying level of Bloom's taxonomy. Applying is whatsoever knowledge they have acquired, how they are able to apply that knowledge in some real life scenario, right? So I'm again, with that disclaimer, I'm not a biotechnology expert at all. I'm an electronics person. But then when you read the question statement from there, you are able to get that whether this question is getting aligned with solving any real life scenario, solving any real life statement or not. That doesn't seem to be happening in this question. So this doesn't, I feel again, I rather strongly feel this doesn't fit into the level 4 of the taxonomy, which is applied. Okay. Otherwise, no. You have put in a lot of effort in preparing this. Could we just have a look at the COs as well of this course, particular course?
CO, sir?
CO, yeah.
One second.
That was a part of the format as well, according to which the whole exercise was supposed to be done. Uh, I'm sure you must have paid attention to the COs which were given in Dr. Praveen Kumar's civil engineering paper, for which we all had a lot of appreciation. Yes. That the COs itself have been framed according to the levels of Bloom's taxonomy. CO4, if you remember, it was related to design. There was another CO which was related to evaluate also. Right. So I'm sure if you're not able to find it right now, that is absolutely
okay. I have it. I'll take another 2 minutes, sir.
Okay. And in the meantime, next in queue would be Professor Shivani. Are you ready?
Yeah, Dr. Rajneesh, I'm ready.
Yeah, okay. So next in line, Professor Shivani would be presenting one question paper. And then next would be Professor Chirag, because he has also sent a message to me that he would like to present a paper. Professor Chirag.
These are the COs?
Yeah. Dr. Vijay, I would request you to comment on the COs, please. You are an expert in the same. So COs for a biotechnology course. And which level course it is, Professor Nita, you were told that it's a first year course or?
It's a third semester, second year course.
It's a second year, so 2-1, second year, first semester course. Professor Vijay, are you there? Would you like to comment on the COs?
Seems okay in line, basically, with what is expected. As far as you can say, I'm not, as you already explained that I'm not biology person from biology. So otherwise it seems okay, but certainly CO is a forte of the course coordinator itself. No one else can, otherwise basically can go deep into it. So as far as the Bloom taxonomy verbs are concerned, they have been used and the COs have been framed. So that is what basically my introductory remark from CO for CO is. So in depth, it is the course coordinator or the course instructor, he or she knows better. But it seems okay as far as the basic thumb rule is concerned.
Yeah, right.
Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Nita. I'm sure these comments from Professor Vijay and from myself as well would definitely help other participants as well to align their question papers with right COs and with right Bloom's taxonomy level as well. Thank you so much, sure. Professor Nita.
Thank you.
Professor Shivani, may I request you to please share your screen and give a quick glance of the question paper which you thought of showing it to the participants. And Professor Chirag, I would request you to kindly confirm your presence in the chat window for the next presentation.
I hope, Dr. Rajneesh, it's visible.
Yeah, it is clearly visible. Please go ahead.
Before I scroll down to this question paper, I want to say we are not claiming at all that this question paper is a perfect question paper. Right. We have just given a sample question paper just to sensitize that any level of Bloom's taxonomy is possible to be framed even in the introductory courses. Right. And what elements are required to be there in a question paper? We have just tried to, imbibe them in this basic question paper. So these are the course outcomes. This question paper is that of first year engineering course, basic of electronics, and 5 course outcomes have been drafted for this course using Bloom taxonomy verbs. Students will be able to identify different electronic components, thus will be able to understand their functionality and the application. They'll be able to apply the fundamental principles. They'll be able to apply the concept of logic gates and integrated circuits in electronic. They'll be able to collect, analyze, and interpret the input-output characteristic of electronic devices through experimental data, identify and differentiate generic IoT modules and sensors used in different IoT applications. So all the course outcomes, those are drafted for a particular course. Actually, the course coordinator do that seeing the content of the course. that after delivering the content, what the student will be capable of doing on completion of the course. This one is a sample question paper. I'll just run down through it, and you will find different tables, figures, right, scenarios have been incorporated in the question paper to make it more interesting for the students who undergo the evaluation. Different scenarios have been highlighted here in order to check different capabilities and the skills those are there in the students in order to categorize them into different categories as something for the advanced learners, right? The majority of portion for all sort of learners, so that everybody gets every portion in the same question paper. So you can see now I'll come on to the first part of it, right? We started the paper with the very basic question, right, to state whether true or false, the conductivity of silicon is always less than that of the germanium at room temperature, which is that of, remembering sector. Then we wanted them to compare BJT and JFET, though the question would have concluded at the end to compare BJT and JFET, right? But what we wanted them, to compare them on the basis of some specific parameters. And we define those parameters in the question paper itself so that they are able to distinguish these two transistors on the basis of these parameters. So that is what we were saying, that what we are expecting from the students. If you leave a question open-ended, like compare on the basis of BJTs and JFETs, he or she may choose any of the parameters, but then what you were expecting them to do may be something different, Right. So you need to exactly specify in your question itself, what is your expectation? On which basis you want to distinguish these two entities or two transistors? Now, in the question two, you can see, right, we have taken an assumption. We wanted student to assume a circuit which is having a battery, a bulb, and a diode, right, and to connect them in series. Rather than simply asking a student to make a series circuit using the battery, bulb, and diode, we have given a scenario, we have asked him to sketch this and write the steps. That is the procedural thinking we wanted to understand from him. And then further, we asked him to identify the basic property of the diode that will be further used in this experiment. So in this way, I'll just scroll it down. And we'll come up to the next part of the question, that is calculate the value of current across Zener diode and voltage drop across the load resistor. We have already given a circuit diagram to the student. The values are already defined of the circuit elements that are present in it. Now we wanted him to calculate that for this particular circuit. I'll come on to the another question, right? Say a question of level creation, right? Here we are. So a 555 timer, that is what we teach to first year engineering students, 555 timer. We have already told them that 555 timer can be used to generate a square waveform. Now, what is our requirement? Right. Our requirement is to design a circuit which could give a 50% duty cycle at a particular frequency, and the frequency is already defined. We ask them to use specifically an external capacitor of a defined value in the desired circuit, and then to sketch the circuit diagram for the same defined values. Right. So in this question, the student is required to create that circuit using the requirements that are there in this question. Now, we wanted student to consider a situation, right? A situation in which an ordinary fan used in the room is replaced by an IoT-enabled fan. The average energy consumed, we gave that by an ordinary fan while working for 6 hours a day, it takes 10 unit and each unit costs XYZ, that is being defined. If the IoT enabled fan reduces daily average energy consumption by 20%, calculate the amount of energy and the money saved by this replacement. So here in this case, the student has to apply, right, all the logics and the, you know, the basic things being taught in that particular subject. So this part, this question is of the application, is of application cater, where he has to apply the logic in order to give the answer to this question. And I want to repeat one thing, right? Somebody was saying that what we mentioned about that remembering and understanding, applying, analyzing, right? These are the four levels that should be there in the question paper. What was said was that in any question papers, these levels are must, right? So quite possible that in all the courses, you can't inculcate, evaluate, and create to that order as that of analyze and analysis or applying level of Bloom's taxonomy. Then does that mean that this is not required, right? While we are framing a question paper, all the Bloom's level are required to be catered, you know, but if in certain courses, if you think it is not possible, till analysis, right, all the questions should be like there till a level of analysis, that is L4. Right, L5 and L6 is what we were telling in this reformation workshop, that we should be able to inculcate them in our question papers, because these are the two levels which are minimally touched upon in case of traditional question papers. So it, as you can see, right, the number of questions which are catering to these level from L1 to L6 of the Bloom's taxonomies are defined here, and the marks are written just beside them, and the weightage of COs, 16% of CO1, 40% of CO2, 20% of CO3, 12% of CO4, and 12% of CO5 are covered. So through this question paper, we just wanted to say that this is just, one effort of ours to bring a sample question, which include all sort of elements, right? The diagrams, the scenarios, the tables, right, and also include all Bloom's level. Yeah, that's all from my side, Dr. Rajneesh.
Yeah, thank you so much, Professor Shivani. Could you just go down, scroll down to the last page of the paper?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, please keep on scrolling down. Yeah. See, what I just wanted to insist upon here was, see, the kind of the participants must appreciate that how elaborative the questions are, and there are diagrams, there are figures, everything, right? So that's what the suggestion has been throughout this workshop, that please don't be shy on using more words when you are asking a question in the question paper. Please be more elaborative, include a lot of diagrams, few tables, include graphs, include real life pictures, to real life scenarios. That's what the situation is, so that the student feels elated while attempting a question paper. I think quite a good question paper, Professor Shivani. Next, I've been getting a lot of requests, but unfortunately, somehow I'm not able to promote everybody to the panelist role. I've just promoted Dr. Dr. Surinder Kumar. Dr. Surinder, are you? No, Dr. Surinder, just a minute. Dr. Sunender Kumar. Dr. Sunender, if you are able to listen to me, Dr. Sunender, you expressed a wish to present your paper. Dr. Sunender. Dr. Sunender, if you could unmute yourself, and because you wrote in the chat window that you want to present your paper.
Okay, sir, just a minute, I open my file.
Very good. So we're able to see you very clearly.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, please, you can introduce yourself and then give us some feedback about this workshop which you have attended. You have invested significantly large amount of your time. Thank you so much for the same. And then please present your paper.
Sir, where is the present of the share screen?
Yeah, share screen.
Sir, have you seen
able to see? Yeah, we are able to see your screen.
Okay, sir. Myself, Dr. Sonendra Kumar Gupta from Oriental College of Technology, Bhopal. And I am the professor in the mathematics department. And I'm professor of the mathematics. Here we discuss about the some mid-semester paper which are delivered in the second semester, June 2021. And
Professor Sonendra, before that, before you start presenting your paper, my humble request, if you could give us some feedback about the workshop, how have been your last 2 days of attending this, all the sessions of the workshop, okay, including sir. Today's session also.
Okay, so the last 2 days we have discussed about the many COs and POs as well as the key, how to set the paper and how to take the examination as well as we have discussed in the last 3 days, that was 26, 27 and today 28, we have discovered the paper presentation and how to prepare the question paper like this. So for this, I have prepared this question paper and there are some certain criteria like this. Question number one, describe the entrance equation, which is related to the Bloom technology level L1. And this is related to the CO3 and the performance indicator like the 1.4.1. Similarly, explain the radius of curvature and drive it because in the mathematics, most of the word either use the describe, solve, evaluate like this. Because in the engineering mathematics, they are the very laser diagram oriented questions. So that we have not very much broad area, so we use in the question paper. So very limited portion we to write our question paper. That's all.
Okay. Could you just scroll down? All would like to have a look at all the questions in the question paper, please.
Yes, yeah, sir. Okay. Question 2, be the part of the ellipse x square upon a square y square upon b square cut off by the latest rectum. Now this is a this is related to the level 5, difficult level, CO2, and is given the marks is 3.5.
Okay. So the question paper is having 10 questions, basically.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
This is the actual question paper which are conducted in the second semester examination, June 2021.
And it is an end term examination or it's a kind of mid-semester examination?
This is a mid-semester examination.
Okay.
This is the actual question paper.
Yeah, that's absolutely fine. And you might have added these additional columns like CO and then Bloom's taxonomy level and performance indicator you might have added later.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay, fine. Could you just go to the top of the question paper, please? Top of this document. Top of the question paper, please. Dr. Vijay, I would request you only to give comments on this question paper. Professor Sonendra, I would request you to kindly go on the top of. Oh, yes.
It doesn't matter even if the screen is not shared. Basically, mathematics is very close to my heart.
Now, that is why I told you.
That it comes to the question paper setting and assignment setting because I have been interacting with wherever basically I got opportunity to interact.
Professor Vijay, but for the benefit of other participants, I think we need to request Professor Sunendra to share that. Share your screen, Professor Sunendra. Please continue to share your screen so that Professor Vijay is better able to give the input.
Just one thing basically which I feel if you go through the PO statements also or through the examination policy, the performance indicators or competencies, mathematics generally or the other related science subject or even the engineering science subject, we teach them just to use them as tool whenever it is required to solve some engineering problem. So that is what basically basic philosophy of introducing the science, basic science courses and the engineering science courses is. Because engineer, as we have discussed, it has to deal with the interdisciplinary groups and the interdisciplinary type of problems. So all these mathematical basic science courses, as well as the humanity courses and basic engineering science courses, they all act as tool to solve the complex engineering problem. This is one thing. So when we see the question paper of mathematics, even this question paper or any other question paper, we do not find anything, any iota of engineering there. How basically that particular engineer who is going through this course will apply this tool as when he is requiring this. So it is always you can say essential, and it is you can say the higher expectation, that third pillar of OBE from basic science you can say faculty, that they have to come up to the expectation of OBE, and they should prepare their assignments, not only assignments but also the question paper, to align with some engineering problems, and then only the things will improve. And the student will also start taking interest in these subjects. Otherwise, what happens, students do not take any interest in the basic science courses because they feel that it is not at all related with the engineering. So if you want to create the interest of the engineering student to be attentive, we have to add that basically, you can say, masala into your basic science assessments, teaching, as well as the question paper and all that. So that is what basically my, you can say, take is, if you go through, scroll down your question paper, you won't find anything related to engineering there. And whatever you are teaching is supposed to be considered as a basic tool for engineers to solve the problem. I simply take one example that basically is not only, you can say, it is the, I say that it is the lacuna of the system, or that that is why the students are not taking this particular, these subjects, taking that much interest in these subjects. First thing we have to understand, when a tool should be introduced. If we say the other tools, other engineering tools, which as MATLAB or any other software, ANSYS or whatever it is, we teach the problem first and then we introduce tool, that this is the problem. It is very difficult if you go manually. If we take example of, you can say, control system theory, and if I want to find out the gain and all that, input or output or input, and the Laplace is to be solved manually, it is difficult. Though mathematician already introduced that mathematical concept of the Laplace, but it is difficult. But when we take another tool, MATLAB, and ask the student to solve, and then we learn, they take interest because they find it very easy, because that tool is easy. So if we are teaching a tool, then it's, unless until it is related to the problem first, that this is the problem, these are the statements. Suppose you are teaching Laplace, or suppose as a mechanical engineer, I have to use conduction equation later. So if you introduce that conduction equation first, that this is the type of differential equation, partial differential equation, that is dealing with the conduction, heat conduction problem, and this can only be solved using this type of tool. So unless until we put those things into the assessment, teaching assessment, it is not, you can say, our students are not going to be benefited. So that is what basically I feel the third pillar is very important of this OBE, that is the higher expectations and higher expectations from us, that all of us has to contribute to that higher expectations. We have to set very high standard, and we must understand these things, and then only we will be able to produce such engineers which can use those basic tools to solve engineering problems. So that is what basically I thought. Secondly, even if suppose you have just basically said that it is not possible to give the graphs, figures, and it is not like that. One ellipse problem I was seeing, you can give some graphical picture of that mathematical, you can say, shape, ask them to write the equation for that. So you have to find out the ways and means, because each and every skill is important. Going through the statement, then converting into the data, that is also important. In mathematics, certainly we can do that. So that is what basically I feel as far as this mathematics course is concerned. We should prepare our assignments as well as the assessment so that the engineering component is ensured. And we should explain in a way that this is a tool which you have to use for solving complex problem. And that is only possible if we introduce the whatever we are teaching, some graph we are teaching, some equation, partial differential equation, or some other, because mostly it is partial differential equation. If we can connect that, this is the wave equation, this is the heat conduction equation, this is other type of, you can say, some electromagnetic wave equation. So those things we have to introduce, and the questions we have to ask from those things, connecting these engineering problem with the mathematics. So that is what basically my take on it. So thank you, Professor Rajneesh, giving this opportunity to interact with all audience regarding my views on mathematics or any other tool. It is not only the mathematics, whatever basic science courses and engineering science courses, including everything. It is only the specialized engineering courses, they are different, because there we get the complex problem, but we have to use all basic science courses, humanities courses, and basic engineering science courses as a tool. So that basically we should be, you can say, have to be a bit careful about this. So thank you, Professor Rajneesh.
Ultimately, it's all about, joining all these fields of learning for some application, because for the holistic development of an engineering student, when he would be able to combine all this knowledge, only then he would be able to come up with some real life solutions to real life problems. Dr. Sunender, you want to add something? Yeah, please.
Yes, sir. Basically, when we discuss about the engineering mathematics 3, which is related to the, especially for the numerical analysis, and discuss the solution of algebraic transcendental equation, when we solve the solution of algebraic equation, for example, the Newton-Raphson method, or secant method, or bisection method, now these methods we also solve by the Android application, as well as some programming skill by the Python or C++.
Very good.
We have also discussed in the classes.
Very good. You're already doing that. Please bring that in your question papers as well.
Right?
So that is what the
suggestion is. Because these are the questions are not related to the our syllabus. That's why we are not putting the question paper.
I am sure you will find some ways and
because when the NEC team or the NBA team visit in our colleges, then we ask about him, why you add this question and this question. Now given this question as an assignment, and they have solved and they submit there as in a CD form, and I'm just put in your department.
Thank you so much, Dr. Sunender. I'm sure the point which Professor Vijay wanted to make, that point has been very well taken. And you have, and I'm very glad that you've already been doing it. See, that's what I always keep on saying. Yes, together we'll be able to see great examination reforms in our country for the betterment of our student community and then country at large as well. Right, it's already, we had originally thought of having this session up to around 12:30 p.m. or so, then we extended it by another half an hour or so, looking at such an overwhelming response of all the participants. I'm really so sorry that we've not been able to accept the request from all the participants who really wanted to present their papers. Particularly, there is a professor, Professor Jagdish. He has sent text so many number of times. I tried my level best from my side to promote him as a panelist, but unfortunately, I failed to do that. I don't know what is the reason for the same. But acknowledging his name and all appreciation for his keenness to present his work as well. Professor Jagdish, maybe we will connect offline sometime. And our team here at Chitkara University, under guidance of Honorable Vice Chancellor Dr. Archana Mantri, then Professor Vijay, Professor Shivani, myself, we always remain available to give any kind of suggestions related to the theme of this workshop. So we can always get connected offline of this workshop as well. I think this is high time that we should call it a day for this workshop. I would request, I really wanted to invite Professor Punia toward the end of the workshop, but I see perhaps he might be busy somewhere going to his other busy commitments. I would request Colonel Venkat to kindly give his closer remarks on the way this workshop has been conducted. And we really thank you so much, sir, for all your encouragement, for giving us this opportunity, as it has been a wonderful experience. This is what we have been talking among ourselves all the time. And we are trying our level best to make sure that the participants ultimately should get benefited from the contents of this workshop. And means we should be able to give ourselves to the expectations of AICT also, right? So we request Colonel Venkat, if you are available, if you could just give your closing remarks for this workshop for a couple of minutes. Colonel Venkat, if you are available, please. Colonel Venkat, are you available, please? Okay, participants, I think there is some issue at his end, or he might be busy somewhere else. But we are really privileged to have such an enthusiastic participation from all the participants in this workshop. I'm sure we'd definitely cross our paths in some academic meetings, some academic tasks, definitely again. Please don't feel any kind of hesitation in approaching us back in case you feel that we can be of any kind of help. Learning is always mutual. Let me assure you of this thing, that more than perhaps what you might have learned, we have learned even more than you. That is what the strong feeling from our side, from all the panelists. And thank you so much for attending this workshop. Rest of the proceedings in terms of the certificates, etc., that will be taken care of by AICT office. And wish you very, very all the best for all your academic endeavors in time to come also. Thank you so much for attending this workshop. Thank you so much. So we'll close the session now. Thank you so much.